but show and show business.
Showtime!
She makes you laugh, she makes you cry.
Got about 3,000 records. La, la,
la, head fast.
Yeah, but just tell us.
She's mad.
What can you say? She's dolly.
Dolly Parton, the Queen of Country Music, is back in the UK for a series of triumphant concerts after an absence from the stage that's lasted nearly 20 years.
She's back!
But I do a pretty good Jolene at karaoke nights.
You do?
Although she's Nashville's first showbiz superstar, with a face and a body known all over the world, for the last decade her music has rarely been played on the radio. Three years ago, she mounted an extraordinary comeback with a return to her roots, a series of albums celebrating the bluegrass music she grew up with in the Smoky Mountains of Tennessee.
You thought these were the Great Smoky Mountains, didn't you?
The guy when they said you were going to be here, and the guy on my record goes, oh, yeah, Dolly Parton's going to be on the show.
That's a cool account.
She's the hardest working woman in show business, a powerful businesswoman, and a singer who manages to be intimate with millions. An all-American icon with international appeal.
I'm Dolly Parton.
The original platinum blonde.
If you want the rainbow, you've got to put up with the rain. Do you know which philosopher said that? Dolly Parton.
Up on sugar.
But you know, I was born and raised in Tennessee. We didn't have anything money could buy. In fact, we was pretty poor. Folks on welfare used to bring us stuff. And I ain't kidding either. We used to toss a coin, see who was going to get to wear the good dress to school. My brothers didn't like it when they won. In my Tennessee mountain home, life is as peaceful as a baby's sigh.
Dolly's early life could have come straight out of a country song. The fourth of 12 children, she was born in 1946 to Scots-Irish sharecropper Robert and his half-Cherokee wife, Avie Lee, into a life of grinding poverty. Dolly's family had no electricity or running water in her early childhood. As a sharecropper, her father worked a plot of land in return for a share of the crops. Even in a good year, they had barely enough to live on.
My folks were just simple, poor mountain people. We lived on a farm, so we grew our own hogs for our own meat. We had our own milk cows. We had to do the milking. We had our own chickens. We all had our chores to do. Our lives were very, very hard, more so than you might know or that I can even say. Mom was 15 and Daddy was 17 when they married. My dad wasn't able to read and write. He never went to school. Most people back in the mountains like that, they all have big families. My dad's from like a family of 15. And most of those kids have to, when they get big enough, go to work in the fields and work to get food on the table for the rest of them. But he was real smart. Numbers he knew. I mean, we didn't have any money, but what little he had, but he could count it like that in his head. There was music always in our family from my mother's people. They all played some sort of musical instrument. We'd sit out on the porch or sit around the heater in the wintertime singing and picking.
She made her first guitar. Now, it wasn't no beauty, but she found some old strings that her Uncle Bill had took off of a guitar. And so she strung her up a guitar on something or another, and she'd plunk on it and made her first song before she was 7 years old.
I think being the fourth one down, I didn't get paid a lot of attention. I was the kind of kid that needed a lot of attention. And Mom and Daddy loved us all. They loved us all the same, but we didn't get picked up or singled out unless we was in trouble or sick. So I would use my music. I would take my guitar and I would just kind of go off to myself or go up in the woods or go up, sit by the barn, entertain the pigs and chickens. And so when other people would come to visit us, I'd just sing something I'd written or sing a song I knew. And people would say, well, that is really good. And so then I'd realize I was doing something good, so it made me want to get better and better because I was getting more attention now than the other kids.
Dolly sung all the time. She was washing dishes or whatever. She just loved to sing, and she loved it so good. And she never had to beg her to sing, because she'd say, you ask her to sing, well, she's ready.
And I was up at her house one night, and I heard her in the kitchen washing dishes and singing. And I thought to myself, wow, that's good, you know. So I went in there and talked to her, and I was working on a radio station in Knoxville.
At the age of 10, Uncle Bill took Dolly to Knoxville to meet Kaz Walker, a grocery store magnate who sponsored the Farm and Home Hour on local radio. He gave Dolly her first chance to perform live, an opportunity that she seized with both hands.
What's the thing, Dolly?
When she sung that first song, everybody in the radio studio upstairs left all the equipment and everything to come down and see what she looked like. I mean, she really got their attention. They left their jobs, and the secretaries and everybody come down the stairs to see who this girl was, you know.
And I remember I had to sing the same song about 3 or 4 times, and I mean, that to me, that's the most exciting thing. It's like that they love me that good. And I remember my uncle and I were going back to his old beat-up car to go back home. I remember looking up at him and saying, I'm going to be a star, ain't I? Because I can do it, can't I? They like me, don't they? So that was the moment that I realized that I was never going back, that was what I was going to do for the rest of my life.
A year later, Dolly cut her first single, co-written with Uncle Bill.
My first little record was on Gold Band Records. That's when I was little, like 10, 11. It was called Puppy Love, not the famous one, the unfamous one.
It wasn't no hit, but it was our first record, and we was proud of it, you know.
Dolly spent much of her teenage years on the road with her uncle, performing at local country fairs and pushing demos. She continued to appear on Kaz Walker's radio shows and later on his local TV program. Dolly was the first of her family to go to high school in the conservative town of Sevierville. It was here that she began to cultivate a look that singled her out.
There was this woman in our hometown, and she was called a loose woman. She had a short skirt. She had beautiful skin, almost like she wore hose. I mean, I remember so plain. She had red toenails, red fingernails, bleached hair, red lipstick. And I just thought she was beautiful. And I remember saying, oh, she's so pretty, she's so pretty. Mama would say, oh, she's just trash. And so I thought in my mind, that's what I want to be when I grow up, trash. I was very unusual at a very early age. And my grandpa being a Pentecostal preacher, me looking like I wanted to look. I wanted my hair bleached, I wanted to wear makeup, I wanted to wear tight clothes, and that was a no-no in our religion. But I would talk Mama into helping me, like if I wanted to say, Mama, would you put some pads underneath my bra so I could push them up a little bit? You know, she said, you better never tell your daddy I did that. She'd do it, though. In between times, I would go back and forth to Nashville with my uncle. Like every several months, we'd take a bunch of songs there, try to get me on record.
It was tough. There just wasn't a whole lot of girl singers that actually was out there. They really had to believe in you before they'd record you as a girl.
The day after she graduated high school, Dolly left home for good and arrived in Nashville with no money and a burning ambition. The same day she stepped off the bus, she met a young blade called Carl Dean at Wishy Washy Laundromat. And one aspect of her future was sealed. They married 2 years later. But marriage wasn't going to change Dolly's drive and ambition. She told Carl the day they met that her career would always come first.
When Dolly arrived in Nashville in 1964, there were really only two role models, the two large role models to go by, and that was Kitty Wells, who represented the old-fashioned Appalachian fervor style. The other role model was Patsy Cline, the ballsy, aggressive singer. There really weren't a lot of female stars. Because it was so prejudiced against women, you had to be twice as good as a man to make it.
Being a woman served me well. You know, it's like some women say, oh, it was so hard being a woman. But I also had all those brothers, my dad and all my uncles that I was close to, so I understood how men were. I loved men, and they didn't scare me in any way. I had a lot of confidence in myself, and so I just kind of made it all work for me, and I wasn't too bad looking at that time.
I had never heard of her, of course, and a friend of mine, he called me and he said, would you listen to a girl singer? I think is great. I said, sure. he said, well, Capitol's turned her down. Everybody has, I think. So I gave him a time, and she came out the next day with her uncle, Bill. So she sang me four songs, and I said, wow, you know, I loved it. She had everything I always look for in an artist. She had individuality, she had uniqueness, and she had presence. She had everything, you know. So when she finished, I said, okay, come back in the morning and pick up your contracts. She said, are you sure? I said, yes, why? She said, well, everybody's turned me down. I said, so? It's not my problem.
I was it was a diamond in the rough at that time, so he had to have a great vision to see all the things that he thought were possible.
People who had turned her down, everything, just thought, well, she's too strange, too weird, the voice is too strange. One even referred to her as sounding like a screech owl. That was my blessing that he did that, because I got her. I thought she was wonderful.
By the early 60s, everybody wanted the teen dollars that rock and roll brought. Country was a very struggling art form that was associated with inbred moronic rednecks that no radio stations wanted any part of.
And so I suggested that, you know, she sing more pop-type material. And then she came to me very, very unhappy and said, if you don't want me to sing country, I want you to give me a release right away. So I didn't want to lose her, of course. So I said, fine. I was looking for a unique type song, and Curly Putnam had one. And one of the few things Dolly hasn't written is called Dumb Blonde.
I went in there looking like a hick, like trash, looking like a dumb blonde. But then after I got through talking to him, Curly said, that's no dumb blonde. So anyway, he wrote this song for me. He said, I want to write you a hit song.
Don't try to cry.
Dumb Blonde was a country hit and brought Dolly to the attention of top country star Porter Wagoner. The flamboyant hillbilly singer hosted a traditional country variety show on regional TV, which was massively popular in the South.
Direct from Nashville, Tennessee, here's the Porter Wagoner Show.
In what was to prove a momentous decision for both of them, he chose Dolly as his new female sidekick.
Let's give her a great big welcome as she sings a song that she had a big hit on called Dumb Blonde. She ain't no dumb blonde, though. Pretty Miss Dolly Parton. How about it?
Don't try to cry your way out of this. Don't try to lie, or I'll catch you in it. Don't try to make me feel sorry for you. Just because I'm blonde, don't think I'm dumb, 'cause this dumb blonde ain't nobody's fool.
It was nerve-wracking when I first started working on Porter's show. Not only was I on big-time television, Porter was one of the biggest stars in the business.
Well, Dolly had such a unique voice. Her voice was much in a higher register, and a brilliant songwriter. That really sold me on Dolly, too.
All of us just thought, you know, it's another girl singer with a very high voice. I thought it was rather shrill, just to be honest, and one that would penetrate just about anywhere, by the way. She was just a very naive, young girl singer that had a mountain of ambition.
Just because I'm blonde, don't think I'm dumb, 'cause this dumb blonde ain't good nobody's fool.
There was no question, once she got there, that she was gonna stay there, come hell or high water, or Porter or whatever.
Porter was a very powerful figure at RCA. He was the only star who was allowed to produce his own records. He was the boss man, and everybody who worked for him was expected to toe the line.
Now I want to call out a little gal here that her and I have had a lot of luck with a couple of single records. I haven't called you out yet. Wait just a minute there, kiddo.
Porter and I were very much alike. We were both country people. We were very passionate, both really headstrong, both believed in what we believed in, but we loved the music.
It's my time. It's my time. It's my time.
Back in their really good days, there was always a sense of humor between them. They were always joking back and forth. Porter would tease her, and she would flirt back. Anytime you get two people like that on the same show, it adds something because there's a spark there. The chemistry was exact.
Her and I were just, when we would sing together, sound like brother and sister. Real blood, blood harmony, I would call it.
It's my time. It's my time. It's my time.
Dolly became Porter's TV wife, and their on-screen flirting inevitably fueled rumours of an affair. They became one of the most successful duos in country music, regularly hitting the country charts.
I think most of us were really impressed when we first started hearing her songs.
While she was with Porter, Dolly wrote some of her most famous songs, classics like Coat of Many Colours, Applejack, and her first number one country hit, Joshua. Well, a good ways down the railroad track, there was this little rundown shack, and in it lived a man I'd never seen. But it was her 1974 smash hit Jolene that really put Dolly on the map.
Jolene, 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 Jolene.
Number one on the country chart and a top 10 hit in the UK 2 years later, it remains one of her signature tunes.
On Top of the Pops right now for you, we have some country and western music for you. Here's Dolly Parton and Jolene.
Jolene, 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 Jolene.
Back in Nashville, her rising star status also brought tension to the TV studio.
When Dolly first came, Porter was her mentor. As the years progressed, Dolly's confidence factor grew, also her following and her music. And there became a little edge there because it almost became the Dolly Parton show.
We bashed heads often. You know, I had my way. When I'd write a song, I wanted it to be done a certain way. And of course, it was my song, but he wanted to do it another way. So we would, usually that's what we would mostly argue over.
We would have a little run-in about something, but I always won because I always would because I'm the boss.
She felt increasingly frustrated with a show that resolutely refused to move with the times.
I wanted to have big-time management. I wanted to get in the movies by that time. I wanted to do everything that a body could do as an entertainer. I wanted to be worldwide. I thought, well, if I'm going to be a star, why not be a big star?
She knew that she could be a girl singer the rest of her life, or she could be Dolly if she went somewhere else.
I started working with Porter for $60,000 a year. That was what the deal was. And that was more money than I'd ever seen or heard tell of. But the thing is, Porter didn't raise me very much. But that was one of the reasons I had to go, because I was part of his group. He was making all the big money, too, because of me. Porter had tried to convince me and had told me over and over, they're going to drop you as soon as you leave the show. They're not going to want you at RCA. So before I had left Porter's show, I flew up to New York from Nashville on my own, made appointments with some of the main people at RCA. I said, well, I'm here to say that I'm going out on my own. I'm going to be leaving the Porter Wagoner Show. I'm going to make a big change here. I'm going to get some pop producers. I want to try to bridge the gap from country. They were very excited. They got totally behind me.
It was tough on an old boy from Missouri to all of a sudden have a lady that you had taught, you thought, everything that she needed to know, who was making moves that you didn't understand anymore.
I knew that it was going to be damaging, and I didn't want that. I thought, well, how am I going to ever tell this man how I feel? I thought, well, I write songs. He won't listen to me. He's way past listening to what I have to say. So I wrote this song, and it came totally from the bottom of my broken heart.
In everybody's life, there's a special person, a person that you love more than you love anybody else. There's this song about that special person in my life. It's called I Will Always Love You.
I think all of us knew there was some serious problems, and all of us watched Porter as she sang it, because at the time it had never really been made clear that that's who she had written it for, but we could all imagine that that's what had happened, and it was her almost an apology or a seeking of understanding.
I hope life treats you kind. And I hope that you have all that you ever dreamed of. And I wish you joy. And I wish you lots of happiness.
She sang it with so much emotion. And it almost put tears in the eyes of all of us.
I wish you love and I love you.
When you've got a subject matter like that, and you sing it with the tenderness and the soul to where it comes from your heart, it don't matter if you have, you can put all the strings and all the voices and all the beautiful things with it, but that song will take you places you've never been. I'm so very proud that she did say she wrote it.
Thank you.
About me or for me, whatever it was.
Thank you so much. We'll be right back after this commercial.
Nashville's Music Row is buzzing today over yesterday's bombshell announcement, the $3 million lawsuit by Porter Wagoner against Dolly Parton.
All I wanted was my percentage of the things I had done for her to that point, because I'd given a lot of my own career to this investment in her. I didn't only produce Dolly's records. I mixed them and everything, and I wanted paid for that.
It was like what money I made for a few years after I left him, 2 or 3 years. He got it. He felt sorry about it later, but it was like he was going to prove to me, you know, that he was going to get it. I said, I don't care. You know, you can have it. I'm going. I have to go.
After 7 successful years, one of the most popular partnerships in country music was over. Dolly left Porter in 1974 to take control of her own career. Porter's show kept rolling for another 7 years, but it was never the same without her. Dolly was soon approached by the biggest star in America, if not the world. But he quickly found out that the little girl from Locust Ridge was no pushover when it came to business.
Elvis had wanted to record I Will Always Love You when I first wrote it. But they wouldn't do it unless I'd split the publishing, and I wouldn't. And I just cried and cried because I wanted so to hear Elvis sing it. So I was always aware of the fact that this was the music business. And I was interested in the business end of the business. And I was not one of those, I didn't want to just get hick rich like so many of my hick friends did, you know, just you know, a bunch of hicks coming straight out of the mountains, and you just get all this quick money and you blow it all, you spend it all, and you know, it's like I wanted to be wise with it.
Right from the beginning, Dolly was developing the sharp business sense that would accompany the rest of her career. In the Nashville of that era, for any artist to own the rights to their material was rare, and for a woman it was unheard of. Not that Dolly took any notice of that.
I was very possessive of my songs because I knew that was going to be what I left for my family, you know, when I was dead and gone. The business people respected me for it, the men, but it definitely was different for a woman because most women don't think that way at all. Even the ones that may be smart in other ways or talented, they're still going to depend on a man to do that, or, you know, a lawyer or somebody. But I always tried to get the best lawyers and the best accountants, and then I'd get somebody to look over their shoulder, too. Me, mostly.
Love is like a butterfly, as soft and gentle as a sigh.
With Porter now behind her, Dolly made a huge step forward when she landed her own Nashville-based TV show.
I remember sitting in the control booth, and I watched her, and she was just a little vibrant little girl that went out and sang, and she was just so honest and so pure, and there's so few of those people. You know, she just lets you into every part of her life, and, you know, there are people out there who sing about life, and Dolly just, what makes her such a big star, I think, is that she lets you live her life with her every day. That I remember walking into the studio while she was filming Coat of Many Colors, and I just thought, what an expose that is of her life.
My coat of many colors that my mama made for me was made only from rags, but I wore it so.
It's about a little coat that my mother had made for me out of scraps and rags, and I was so proud of the coat because I thought I looked like Joseph. And I got to school and the kids all made fun because I was really wearing rags. You know, it was like it was such a painful memory.
When it comes time to sit down and write that, and just say, okay, here's my life. I don't know that I could do that. I mean, I'd like to think I could, but I don't know that I could.
In my coat, many colors, well, I hurried off to school just to find the others laughing and making fun of me. And my coat, many colors that Mama made for me.
Dolly Parton was a part of what country music is written about, and then I kind of was raised listening to what she lived.
Then I told him of the love that Mama sewed in every stitch. Then I told him all the story that Mama told me while she sewed, and just why my coat of many colors is worth more than all their clothes.
2 years on, and with valuable exposure as a solo artist, Dolly's drive, ambition, and dreams of becoming a worldwide star had not diminished. Finally, in 1975, Dolly went to Hollywood, where she met a man who would take her career to the next level, the man behind Cher and Michael Jackson, who was to manage her for the next 20 years.
I thought that having a pop hit record would bring her to the attention of millions of fans that had not known her.
Here you come again, just when I'm about to get myself together.
I just believed that I could do other things. I wanted to try. I had to try. But there were some people, they crucified me right at the start, saying that, I had left my country roots and I was making a big mistake and I'd fall flat on my face and all that. But my first record was Here You Come Again. It went platinum.
Here You Come Again was Dolly's first crossover hit. It reached number 3 in the US pop charts, sold over 1 million copies and won a Grammy. But crucially remained a huge hit with Dolly's original audience, hitting the top spot on the country charts with ease. Dolly's following and popularity was growing apace. In 1977, the Queen of Country even met the Queen of England for the Royal Variety Performance.
And when Prince Philip came by, he picked up my hand to kiss it, and he said, "Oh, my Lord, what's all this?"
By the late 70s, disco was taking America by storm, and Dolly threw herself into another new world with gusto. A shift of musical emphasis and a big glamour injection in the wardrobe department transformed her into the ultimate country disco diva. Camp and larger than life. A string of disco-flavored hits followed, like Higher and Higher. And the massive club hit, Baby, I'm Burning. In 1978, Dolly was feted all over America. Even the mecca of the New York disco scene, Studio 54, threw a party in her honor. This world of drug-fueled hedonism was about as far away from Nashville as Dolly could get.
She was going to Hollywood. She didn't try to be somebody she wasn't. She stayed Mountain Gal Dolly Parton with her fancy hairdos and her whole thing. And she taught country music to stop being ashamed of itself and to stand on its own 2 feet and say, this is who I am and I'm proud of it.
The image that Dolly had cultivated since being a teenager now went into overdrive.
I thought you had to have big hair if you was going to be, you know, in country music. Like, the higher the hair, the closer to God. You know, it's like if I have a bad hair day, I'll just change it right then. I don't have to worry about it. Somebody says, how long does it take to do your hair? I say, I never know. I'm never there.
That's an image she's created for herself. She created Dolly, you know, the visual Dolly. And I think she likes to look like that, and so she is bigger than life, and I think an audience is sort of dazzled by that. She's like a cross between an angel on top of the tree and Mae West or something.
She is one big thing, Dolly Parton. She is very, very funny, very, very nice and good-humored. She doesn't take herself at all seriously. One issue doesn't detract from the other. Some people would have you believe to be a great songwriter, you have to look and behave like this. To be a this, you have to look like that. Nonsense. She's broken all the country and Western country music molds.
People say, well, how do you expect people to take you serious looking like that? How do you expect to be taken serious as an artist if you're going to do this, you're going to do that? I say, hey, I don't expect you to take me any more serious than I take myself. This is fun for me. This is this is joy for me. This is what I'm doing on the surface to make it colorful and enjoyable and playful and fun for me.
Tumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen. Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower.
9 to 5 became one of the defining movies of the 80s. The story of three secretaries who turned the tables on their tyrannical boss, it was a runaway box office hit.
I put up with all your pinching and staring and chasing me around the desk because I need this job, but this is the last straw.
All right, now wait, let's just sit down and...
Look, I got a gun out there in my purse. And up to now, I've been forgiving and forgetting because of the way I was brought up. But I'll tell you one thing. If you ever say another word about me or make another indecent proposal, I'm going to get that gun of mine, and I'm going to change you from a rooster to a hen with one shot.
With my new management, we'd been looking around, but I hadn't wanted to do any movies until A Right Thing come along, because I'm not an actress. I've never taken an acting lesson in my life, and it would have to be something that was pretty much close to me, to my personality. But Jane Fonda, who produced, came up with this idea to do 9 to 5 about women in the workplace. And she had just heard of my fame in the country business, saying, oh, there's this girl that people seem to like. You know, she's got a big heart and a big mouth, and she, you know, people just seem to like her because she's a country girl. Let's get her, because she'll get us the South.
Stuff. Grab your pad and pencil and get your buns in here.
Because Jane Fonda was very famous at that time, and so was Lily Tomlin. I thought, well, I'm going to do this because if it's a flop, I can blame it on them. If it's a hit, I can take some of the credit.
We didn't know whether she was going to be a prima donna or prepared, or maybe she thought this was a lark and not really what she does for a living anyway, so we didn't know. Well, we found out very quickly that she took it very seriously, extremely prepared and ready to go.
Hi, Violet. How's everything going?
I had never in my life had to have such discipline as when I did 9 to 5. I had never even seen a movie made at that time. I didn't know anything about it. I even memorized the whole script. I thought it was like a play.
The rest of it was a reading. We hadn't even started memorized. She knew her entire part.
When they'd forget their lines, even before the script lady would, I'd just say, I would tell them what their line was.
She has a great way of disarming the crew, for instance, because obviously she could be the source of some jokes, and I won't even tell you why. I think it's rather obvious, but she will walk onto a stage and say something to totally disarm that aspect, make them laugh, make them feel like a friend, like they want to protect her, not say anything wise or hurtful about her. They all stood up for Dolly. In about 30 seconds, it took her to disarm the entire crew.
And these two men started to hassle us in the parking lot, and they just wouldn't let up. And so I was going to be big because I had a gun. So I reached to get my gun, and I shot a hole clean through my purse.
She's an artist, and so she can sense how to communicate herself. I don't think it's fair for her to say about herself that she's not an actor at all. She certainly is. Like when she sings a song, she's acting. And she acts the hell out of a song.
I take a script. If the story's there, I live that story and act that story the way I would if it was really happening to me. And that's what they say you're supposed to do anyway. But same as like singing a song, I take a song and whatever I'm feeling about it, it comes out.
She was bigger then. She was a little bit fleshier. And honest to God, her bust was stuck out so far, Jane and I would run into it. We'd forget. It was sort of so far out of like what anybody expected in life that very often we'd turn and your peripheral vision did not protect you. You just, you know, you have a little collision.
The film industry is the most boring thing I've ever done in my life because you sit for hours and hours waiting for them to set up lights. I thought, well, I don't know if I can start writing songs because then I won't be in my character. And then I thought, who are you kidding? You're not that much of an actress.
Dolly came out on set and she just finished writing 9 to 5, the theme song. And she played it for us by keeping the rhythm on her fingernails, you know. So it was one of those blips up where you thought, Jesus, this is a great song. You know, this is just gonna add so much to the movie. And it kind of made you understand in essence what the movie might be about and how it would communicate to an audience. And it was a very big hit.
Dolly's theme tune became a pop and country smash, won 2 Grammys, and was nominated for an Oscar. 9 to 5 had been a delight, but Dolly's next experience of movie making was quite a different picture. 1984 saw Dolly in The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, co-starring Burt Reynolds. It was to prove one of the worst periods of her life.
Really, a lot of bad things happened on that movie. Burt was in bad health at that time. A lot of backbiting, and it was a bloodbath. A lot of the producers being changed, people being fired left and right.
9 to 5 was such an idyllic experience with, the family feeling, and she was so new, and she just jumped into it and just, seemed to love every minute. Best Little Whorehouse, I think that was hard for her to have a set that really didn't come together. I think how she's always protected her friends and protected everyone around her, I think she was not able to do it on that show, and I think it hurt her.
The traumatic shoot for Best Little Whorehouse in Texas began to take its toll on Dolly. For the first time in her life, she found her punishing work schedule difficult to meet. During that period, she was questioning whether she would ever have children. And to compound her problems, she started to put on weight.
I am now beginning to have to be more conscious of my weight, because I am quite a bit overweight for my height. I'm only 5 feet tall. And I never say how much I weigh. I usually say I weigh 100 and plenty.
The toughest part of it was just seeing her so unhappy. A lot of it had to do with exhaustion. She had worked her tail off for several years, and I think maybe she just couldn't find a peaceful place to be.
She just sacrificed everything that most people take for granted. She knew what she wanted to be, and she knew what it was going to take to be what she wanted to be, and she took that step. And she said, I love children, you know I do, but she said, I've watched women singers get on the bus and have to leave their children. And she said, I couldn't do that.
The fantasy part of me, or maybe it's the other way around, the mother part of me always wanted to have children, because I grew up in a family of 12. So I was so involved in my work, and I really felt that was my true calling. I did used to feel guilty about it, because I thought that's what all women were supposed to do.
It wasn't that she didn't want children, it was just that she knew it wouldn't be fair to the child. That was a hard way to go. And many times she's had shed many tears when nobody didn't know. I wondered where the love had gone that we'll be
and again I felt the lonely coming down. She obviously just had to go through this period.
And I didn't try to push her to work, because I knew that she was so special and so smart that she would find her way out of this, which she did.
So I think it was just God saying, will you sit your fat ass down and take inventory and then get off your fat ass, get that weight off of you and get on with your life.
18 months down the line, Dolly had come to terms with her life choices, shed the weight, and bounced back brighter than ever. She toured Britain in 1983 and took London by storm. Having won over the British public, a jubilant Dolly returned home to hook up with an old singing buddy.
Baby, when I met you, there was peace unknown.
Barry Gibb wrote the song and produced it. I was in the recording studio singing it, and it sounded horrible. I mean, I have to tell you, I would have taken it off the album in a heartbeat. And Barry was sitting there and said, you know what this song needs? This needs Dolly Parton. The minute she walked through that door, there was something magical happened, and the record took on a life of its own from that moment on.
That one's just really been a big one in my life. I love that song. I never get tired of singing it.
The chemistry was great. Audiences absolutely loved Dolly and Kenny working together, you know, everywhere in the world.
Excuse me, Kenny. How can we be wrong?
Dolly has chemistry with whoever she works with. You don't get an exclusion on that. I mean, I remember thinking, this is pretty cool. I have electricity with Dolly. Then I see her with Vince Gill. She has, electricity with Vince. She has electricity with everybody she works with. So I don't feel very special anymore. Dolly and I think are both at our best when we screw up. And I think that she used to intentionally make me screw up, and then I would pay her back by doing the same for her. Dolly used to give away all my secrets, you know. I would have liposuction, and from the stage, Dolly would say, well, you know, Kenny's been back to Jiffy Suck again. You know, she couldn't let me have any secrets whatsoever.
Islands in the Stream was a smash hit, reaching number one in both the US pop and country charts and cracking the top 10 in the UK. Despite the duo's success and popularity after only two albums, Dolly moved on to other things.
I think Dolly doesn't like to be too closely associated with people. But, I mean, everybody's always like, where's Dolly? Where's Dolly? You know, and of course, I don't know where Dolly is.
I think Dolly likes to move on. She only likes to chew her tobacco once.
Partnership with Kenny brought Dolly back to the peak of commercial success. Back on top, she joined forces with fellow country stars Linda Ronstadt and Emmylou Harris to produce the million-selling trio album. She also found time on her new national TV show to publicly heal some old wounds.
So here he is, the one, the only Porter Wagoner! Porter, I just have looked so forward to this for so many years. I know that we worked together for 7 years. I started with you in 1967, 66?
Yes, that's correct. And it's wonderful to be back.
I just wanted to thank you right here on network television for all the years that you spent trying to help me build my career. And I know we've had our problems, but I just want you to know I love you and I thank you very much.
Well, Dolly, thank you. I love you and I look so forward to this.
The late 80s saw a radical transformation in the Dolly image, the soft edges giving way to a brittle, power-built creature, now much more Hollywood glamour than country coziness.
There's a somebody I'm longing to see. I hope that he turns out to be someone who'll watch over me.
I was very fascinated with her weight loss, how the weight loss changed my perception of her. Something about doing those country and western songs when she was heavy that was different than when she was turned into a really Barbie babe.
The press went to town on Dolly's radical weight loss and the rebuilding of her new 90s image. She was becoming a caricature, celebrated for her nips and tucks rather than for her music. Her tabloid alter ego began to take over.
I had just so admired how she made fun of it takes a lot of time and a lot of money to look this cheap, and talks about it in the most humorous, explicit detail. So talks about her boobs, her hair, her facelifts, her nips and tucks. I guess she must have a real sense of self-esteem to be able to present herself like she does and then say, this is what it is.
Of course you're gonna look at me if you don't really take the time, and you're gonna see hair and boobs, you know, and all the gaud. But if you look long enough and if you listen long enough, you're gonna see that I'm sincere about what I'm doing. I'm even sincere about how I look. It's just, I know what it is. I know, you know, that it could be different, but that wouldn't be right for me. And I think that's been part of what little magic, or if I have any magic, I think a lot of that through the years has been the fact that I look totally artificial, but I'm totally real. And it's a contradiction, but I'm serious about it. I think people know I'm serious about it. I didn't know that you were allowed, you know, to tell some of the stuff you do unless you knew for a fact that that thing was true and you could prove it. Then I realized early on it wouldn't even do you any good to sue them because they got so many lawsuits backed up. You're just wasting good energy on negative things and the next week people's gonna forget it anyway. A lot of people say my husband don't exist. They say I'm a lesbian. I've made up this husband.
He sticks behind the Dolly in the background. He don't want to get in on none of the limelight. He's very private person. And they do spend a lot more time together than people think they do, but they do it secretly in a way that they're not bothered with it.
There's a picture here in one of the articles that we saw. It had a picture, it said Dolly and her seldom seen husband, Carl Dean. And it was me and my hairdresser. My little hairdresser is just gay as he could be. And that's even funnier for my husband. He said, well, did they have to use him, put my name on him? I said, well, yeah, I guess they did.
And here she is, Miss Dolly Parton.
I have met some major drag queens. I have seen a few that really, you know, are beautiful and hope I look that good. Then I've seen some that are so total dogs, I think, my Lord, is that how I look? Is that how they think I look? But it's fun. It's always a compliment, and they have fun doing it. I'm easy to look like. All you need is a cheap wig and a big padded bra.
She's very, very popular in the gay community. Every gay man I know absolutely adores her. I don't know if that's because she's beat out all the odds, and she's been uncompromising in her own beliefs and what she wants to do. I admire the quality that she gives off as such a ditzy blonde and a ha-ha. It's so fun. Underneath it all, she's such a brilliant mastermind for our business and ingenuity.
Whitney Houston's 1992 cover of I Will Always Love You was number one in the UK for 10 weeks. Although it had been a huge country hit in the US, Dolly's version never saw chart success in Britain.
And as a songwriter, you're proud when other people take your songs. You don't care how they do them. You're just glad that somebody liked it enough to do it. When people say, well, she claims it's her record, I said, it is her record. It's my song, but it's most definitely her record. It didn't sound like that when I had it.
And on behalf of myself and the Internal Revenue Service, I'd like to thank Whitney for making my song such an enormous hit. And I really feel good about that, because when I wrote that song 22 years ago, I had a heartache. But it's amazing how healing money can be.
Whitney's went on to sell 30 million records worldwide. It was the second biggest selling single in the history of pop and made her the undisputed queen of R&B. By contrast, Dolly's music had effectively vanished from the airwaves. And for the first time, Dolly's finger seemed to have slipped off the pulse. Record executives developed a growing obsession with the youth market and a new breed of country stars who'd been influenced by rock music, like Garth Brooks. Dolly, now in her late 40s, was left out in the cold.
Well, I didn't miss a beat as far as a songwriter and a singer. I kept writing my songs, and I knew that I had been so blessed in the business. I had had so many good years. I'd won every kind of award that there was to win. And I had been one of the main girl singers in the business for years, so I didn't begrudge the new artists. It wasn't that. I just missed the fact that I didn't have the outlet for it. You know, I wasn't angry about anything or bitter about it, but I also went straight into all my business things.
The touring stopped, and Dolly turned to business with a vengeance. Her portfolio included production and publishing companies, a chain of restaurants, a line in wigs, and of course Dollywood, her 87-acre theme park, which she built in her beloved Smoky Mountains with its own currency.
Dollywood, I just thought I played off of the name of Hollywood, Dollywood, get it, and it being up in the woods. It's like I was trying to be real clever.
Welcome to Dollywood!
I always thought that when I got to be the star that I wanted to be, or hoped I would be, if I got lucky enough for that to happen, that I would want to go back and do something in my home area, something to make my family proud.
Definitely a lady with a heart of gold, raised very, very poor, as everybody knows. And I'm sure that contributes to her need to feel like she needs to share her wealth with lots of people, particularly underprivileged or less privileged folks.
She's made a lot of differences, a lot of changes in this county. The rehab center at the hospital, she raised that program, and they got over $200,000 to open it up. And I attended 3 days a week, thanks to her.
At least she tries to put back into her community. You know, so that means a lot. It really does. And she's a local girl. And we're all, if somebody sees her, hey, Dolly, you know, it's all cute and fine.
Almost all of the people who start to do business with her underestimate both the intellect, the ability, and everything else, and it's because of the surface cosmetic appearance, but she can either destroy you or inspire you with a feather.
We're inside the Tennessee Mountain home, and this is a replica of what Dolly's house actually looked like when she grew up. They were really that poor. The newspapers that you see that are on the wall are really like that in the real Tennessee Mountain home.
Well, it's a lot about me as far as the music and a lot of the merchandise, of course. But we've tried to preserve the Smoky Mountain heritage, what life was like 100 years ago. And although I make a lot of money through the theme park, through Dollywood, I mean, it's a good business investment. But I take greater pride in the fact that it has provided so many jobs for so many of my family and friends and so many of my relatives, because a big part of my relatives, they all sing and perform. It keeps me from having to send them a check every week. I just put them to work.
I love this place. I'm at home, and if I wasn't playing here all day, I'd be at the house playing all day. So it's good to get out here and meet the people. I really love it. This is not just a job for me. It's something that I really love to do. I'm having the time of my life.
Dolly's childhood home had provided the inspiration for her business and now refreshed her music. The new millennium saw a revolution in country music as bluegrass began to hit the mainstream. With her old knack for timing, Dolly released The Grass is Blue, her first ever album of pure mountain music, and was perfectly placed to surf a 6 million selling wave that broke the following year.
I am the man of constant sorrow.
The surprise success of the Oh Brother Where Art Thou soundtrack pushed bluegrass music into the top of the charts and boosted young artists like Nickel Creek and the million-selling Alison Krauss. Forget about it. When you see me on the street, don't wink, don't wave, don't try to tease me with your smile. They'd been inspired by Dolly, and she in turn adopted them. 2001 brought the album Little Sparrow, bringing Dolly right back to her roots as a Smoky Mountain storyteller.
Give me a word, give me a sign. Show me where to look and tell me what will I find. What will I find?
There's a school you have to come up through, I think, of that bluegrass sensibility. You can't fake it. People either know how to play it and they grew up around it, playing it, singing it, and it's in their blood. It's like falling off a log to her. I mean, how could it not be? It's where she comes from.
She's so much in touch with her background, where she comes from. She sings very, very well as a native of the South. You know, she's got that kind of music right down. Sometimes you would think they were folk songs, but they're beautifully constructed. You would think they've been around for years and years.
Love is in the water, love is in the air. Show me where to go and tell me, will love be there?
This music is best suited for my voice. It's music of the heart, of the soul. I think most writers, especially mountain people like me, that comes from that old world of tragic songs of like that were brought over from England, from Ireland, and you know, those Scottish ballads. That's just programmed into us. It's just in our psyche. I call it my Smoky Mountain DNA. It's just in there, and I just love to sing sad songs. I love to write sad songs. I write a lot of new songs, and people say, that's an old song, ain't it? I said, no, that's my song. Just all that English blood in me carried over. Anyway, it goes like this. Little sparrow. Little sparrow. Precious, fragile little thing, little sparrow, little sparrow, fly so high and feels no.
She's made me cry in the studio many times. She'll do a vocal in her reading, but she would just do something that was just so overpowering emotionally that you couldn't help but be moved by it if you were listening.
Well, I would get in a habit of crying every time I'd see her, and she got in there and was working on harmony parts. She's like, is this right? And she's singing it in my ear, and to hear that, you know, naturally was stunning. And she goes, you know, she goes, I ain't even gonna ask you. All you do is cry. That's all you can do. Little sparrow,
little sparrow. Most people would take days or weeks to do all their vocals, and she'll stand up there and in 6 hours sing all the vocals, which is unheard of. She'll do one right after the other, two or three passes on each vocal, and then move on to the next one. Doesn't even come in to rest. She just stands there, flips her lyrics over, and says, we get the next mix up, and she sings.
Now this is a good scratch. Yeah. That was a vocal.
We're both old school. I think there's a lot to be said for old school. If you've got someone like her who can deliver it live, and you don't have to put a record together with smoke and mirrors and tuning vocals and all that sort of thing, there's a lot to be said for that.
She gave me advice on meeting girls and on kissing. And she wanted to know if I would practice with her sometimes. She's always so personable. Always makes you feel like you're really contributing, not like you're a hired gun or anything like that.
In 2002, she released her 72nd album, Halos and Horns.
Halos and horns, sinners and saints.
At 56, she shows no signs of slowing down, embarking on a series of sellout concerts and a relentless publicity tour.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Hello.
Bye.
How are you?
I just love to work. I love what I do. I mean, how many people in the world are lucky enough to get to make a living at what they love to do?
Here we are in Sweden.
You understand what I'm saying?
No. I'm not one that don't ask about my boobs.
Show them.
I think it's funny. So I like to get that off my chest right in front. I am so tired.
So you do this every year, right?
He's cute, too. I'll talk to you later, okay? Thanks. I thank you for being such a good crowd, and I hope to see you somewhere else down the road.
If I should stay, well, I would only be in your way, and so I'll go, and yet I know that I'll think of you each step of the way.
For nearly 40 years, Dolly has prevailed as one of our enduring icons. Even through the bad times, she's always managed to get back on top. For Dolly Parton, the art and business of reinvention has simply become a way of life.
I still feel just as excited about my career right now as I did when I left the Smoky Mountains for good in 1964. A lot of people my age are already, you know, like, they've already gone to seed. You know, they don't want to do anything. And I, for me, though, I would rather wear out than rust out.
I will always love you.
I figure I'll be dead forever. And so I'm just going to do everything I can while I'm living. I hope to drop dead right in the middle of something I love to do. Like a song would be great. I'd love to just die in the middle of a great song that I had written, hopefully.